and that people have her back. So I'm here to tell you that if you feel like the only way people are gonna listen to you is if you take your own life, that's not true. Like, there are people who are watching, you matter right now, today, and if this is something that you're not impacted by directly, but you're pissed off at what happened to Rehtaeh, and you're pissed off that it's happening in your community, or maybe to someone you know, your principal's gonna give you the information afterwards, but Glen and I are sticking around afterwards if folks wanna come and chat with us, not just because you're feeling heavy and maybe you wanna talk about your story, but also because you're like fired up. Those young men in Ottawa that came up with Man Up, these were men who saw Glen speak at City Hall, who went back to school, and for 2 weeks were hounding their gym teacher to be like, we need to do something at this school so this doesn't happen here. And then they started Man Up, which is super, super rad. And I work with them and they are like amazing and super legit. So if that's how you're feeling right now, or not necessarily personally affected, but just like, I don't want this to happen to anybody ever again, then feel free to come join us afterwards and chat with us about how you can make that happen in your school. Maybe you have younger siblings, you want to get them interested as well. We can give you tons of resources on how to keep the conversation going. Sound good? Okay. So now my job is to give you tools to make sure this doesn't happen to other folks and to get you thinking about this on a practical level. And I want to start, okay, it feels wonky from this end, but I think you can read all of it. So I want to start by giving you the legal definition of consent. So on paper, Canada has a very progressive law on consent. And this is literally out of the criminal code. This is not me making this up. This is like straight up, the law says in Canada that consent is the voluntary agreement of the complainant to engage in the sexual activity in question. So what's important to unpack from that is, one, voluntary. So coercion is not consent. If you badger somebody for 3 weeks, texting them nonstop, asking them to do this thing, and then they finally say, like, fine, okay, that's not really consensual. You've coerced that person. You've made them feel like they had no choice. You were going to break up with them if they said no. You were going to tell people things about them if they said no. That's not voluntary. Voluntary is literally in the criminal code. That's really important to understand. Also, it says sexual activity. So it's not just a straight man having sex with a straight woman in the way it's traditionally understood. It does not matter what your gender is, it does not matter the gender of the folks involved, and it doesn't matter what it is, if it's sexual in any way, shape, or form, you need to get consent. And the third part that's important is that it's a sexual activity in question. So because someone said yes to making out with you, that doesn't mean they said yes to like every freaky thing your mind could ever come to, right? If you want to go on to doing something else, you have to check in with that person. So the law is quite clear in saying that I said yes to A, it doesn't mean I said yes to the whole alphabet. Now this is language that like I don't use, so I will break it down, but I'm just giving you directly from the criminal code so you know that it's not me and Glen and our like five feminist friends that like made up with the legal, like this is from the law in Canada. So there is no consent where the complainant is incapable of consenting to the activity. This is where if someone is high or drunk or asleep or unconscious or medically kind of out of it in any way, shape, or form, they are not able to consent. Secondly, where the accused induces the complainant to engage in the activity by abusing a position of trust, power, or authority. It does not matter how old you are. If someone decides whether or not you have a job tomorrow, whether or not you get an A on your paper, whether or not you have access to your kids, whether or not you have access to housing, if somebody can hold something over your head, legally, you are not able to give consent because you might have said yes because you were afraid of what happened to you if you said no. Third, where the complainant expresses by words or conduct a lack of agreement to engage in the activity. In Canada, only yes means yes. I don't have to say no and like clock you in the face for my no to be heard. If I say nothing, if I physically push you away, if I turn the other way, if I just lie there, like that's not me giving consent. You have to get some verbal, enthusiastic, yes, I'm on board with what we're doing right now. The law says that, not me and my friends. That is like straight up out of the law. And then lastly, where the complainant, having consented to engage in a sexual activity, expresses by words or conduct a lack of agreement to continue to engage in the activity. So, I might have been down with what we were doing, now I feel super uncomfortable, or I really just want to go home, or I just like I'm not down with what's going on. I have the right to be like, I said yes, but now I don't want to be here anymore, and we need to stop. And that yes was okay, and my no also has to be. there's no such thing as like, oh, we're too far gone. I say I don't want to be here anymore, I don't have to be here anymore, and you have to respect that. So this is language, like I said, I've been doing this work for 14 years, and like, I don't talk this way, and I do this work all the time. So this translates to this. So, consent is voluntary. Coercion is not consent. This is so important for folks to understand. Peer pressuring, is like we used to say back in the day in like after school prep special, peer pressuring someone to say yes is not a yes under the law. It has to be voluntary. It has to be clear that I am here because I want to be, not because you made me feel like I had no choice or that you would do something to me if I said no. Two, it has to be sober enough for me to know who I am, who you are, what we're doing, what's going on, and then I wake up tomorrow and we both know exactly what happened. That's the legal threshold. That, of course, differs from person to person, but we all know the difference. We all know the difference. And even when you're talking about Rehtaeh's case, if someone is throwing up out a window, who says, like, man, they probably dealt with what's going down? Nobody. It is obvious to all of us when someone is too drunk to be able to walk home by themselves, to be able to get in their car, and to be able to engage in sexual activity with someone. We all know it, we pretend not to, but we all know where that line is. Third, consent has to be enthusiastic, and by that we mean it has to be an obvious, like, yes, I want to be here, yes, I have no doubts about doing this. And then four, it is never assumed, so because you're like, hey, do you want to come to my house and hook up with me, that you might have an understanding of what hookup sounds like, but that person has to be clear so that everyone involved knows exactly what they're signing up for. And the reason why we have this conversation is because Rehtaeh is not alone, Glen is not alone, I am not alone, we are the vast majority of people. 1 in 3 women, 1 in 6 boys, 1 in 5 trans folks will experience sexual violence in their lifetime. That is a lot of people. And I train between 3,000 to 4,000 people a year, which means the vast majority of people that I talk to are people who have been directly impacted by this. And to drive home what Glen said again, it's not just Rehtaeh who was assaulted. It was her dad that was impacted. It was her mom. It was her siblings. It was her friends. Like, this impacts everybody. And if you're sitting in this room, especially if you're a guy, and you think to yourself, I don't know anyone who's been assaulted. I'm here to tell you that you do. They just don't feel safe telling you about it. Either because they assume that you're gonna laugh at them, they assume you're gonna blame them, or you've made jokes about it before, or you've written it off before, or you're giggling at this presentation, or you're gonna make jokes about it when you leave, and that person then thinks to themselves, like, you're not someone that I can talk to. I don't care who you are, if you're sitting in this room and you tell me you don't know someone who's been assaulted, I'm telling you you're wrong. You do. They just don't feel comfortable talking to you, and you just sit with why that is. Also, women under 25 have the highest rates of sexual assault and criminal harassment. Criminal harassment is stalking. Most of us call it stalking, but it's called criminal harassment in Canada. Women under 25 have the highest rates, although women live at risk for their lives. Men, if you're born a boy and you live your whole life a man and you live to be about 18 years old and you're never sexually assaulted, chances of you ever being sexually assaulted are super, super, super low. When I work with men who experience sexual violence, the vast majority are survivors of childhood sexual abuse. But if you're a woman, you're born a girl, and you live your whole life a girl, as you age and as you hit puberty, the chance of you being sexually assaulted skyrockets, whereas for men, it plummets. So when I'm talking, that's what we say, women and boys and trans folks, everybody's impacted, but women live with that fear their whole lives because we live at risk our entire lives. Also super important for folks to understand as we sort of transition into talking about, okay, what the hell do we do about the same lady? Is that less than 10% of sexual assaults in this country are reported to police. Now usually there's like some super smart person who thinks they have like a mic drop moment about like, well, then how do you know? If no one reports it, how do you know? And they feel they're like super, they're like, that's a gotcha moment. The police themselves will tell you that if you compare the amount of people who go to the cops versus the amount of people who access a sexual assault center, or people who access mental health support, or people who fill out a stat scan survey, they will tell you that 90% of the people who've been assaulted never walk through their doors. I live in Ottawa where it's less than 5%. Not awesome. And I don't say that for us to be like, okay, so whatever. It's not okay that people don't feel comfortable reporting, but it's important for you to know that because the vast majority of people are not calling the cops. So if your first thought is, there's no way that happened to you because you didn't call the cops and the cops didn't charge him, so you're obviously a liar, then you have to prepare to tell 90% of the people who've been sexually assaulted that they're liars. Because most people are not going to tell the cops, they're going to tell their friends, they're going to tell a teacher, they're going to tell a faith leader, they're going to tell a family member, which means everybody in this room has to be prepared to hear that news from someone and to be that person who's going to be there for them. Because you're more likely to hear about it than the cops. That's a fact. Also a fact that kind of flies in the face of what most of us were raised to believe is that 80 to 95% of us are assaulted by people that we know. 80 to 95% of us. But most of us were raised with like hardcore stranger danger. So like, hands up if you were raised to believe that it was like, don't talk to strangers and it's like a man in a van who's gonna like tempt you with candies and or puppies. That was a threat to you, hands up. Look around. The vast majority of us were raised with like the Oprah after school special that was like a dude in a van, right? 80 to 95% of us are assaulted by people we know, including children, including adults. This is important for us to understand, just as a fact, but also because you could sit here right now and say, if my friend was assaulted, 100% I would have her back, 100%. But if you know someone who's been assaulted, it means you probably know who also assaulted them. And it is very easy to say, if my friend was assaulted, I would be there for them 110%. Cool, but what if I tell you the person who assaulted them is also your friend? Because that's what's gonna happen. Chances are you know that person too. And then it gets complicated because maybe you care very deeply about everybody involved, right? So I want you to be real with yourself as we talk about what to do to say, I don't want you to tell me what you think I want to hear. Like real talk to yourself about are you actually going to step up when it's someone that you know? Because I live in Ottawa. If I'm waiting at the bus and like some guy is like being a creeper to a woman at the bus stop, like I don't know him, I will give him a piece of my mind and tell him he's a creeper. But if I'm at a party, I grew up in a small town, if I'm at a party with someone I've known since like kindergarten, it's harder for me to call him out because I'm gonna see him again and I've known him my whole life versus some rando that I'm never gonna see again, right? What is important for folks to understand is that as a woman who cares about ending sexual violence, one of the most common things I hear is that I must obviously hate men. That is so wrong and so sad. And nor am I saying that every man in this room is a potential perpetrator. Nobody says that. People like to assume that that's what we're saying, but that's not what we're saying. One in three women experiencing sexual assault does not mean one in three men are perpetrating sexual assault. When I say that statistically, 97% of perpetrators of sexual violence are men, I'm not saying 97% of men are perpetrators. To say that most perpetrators are men is not the same thing as saying most men are perpetrators. What we know is that it's a tiny percentage of men who are overwhelmingly repeat offenders. So research in the United States, for example, found that when someone actually was apprehended for sexual assault, chances were they had assaulted 6 people before they ever got caught. So what we're talking about is like a small percentage of men that make all men look bad. And instead of us being mad at that small percentage of men, we get mad at people like me and people like Glen who call it out for what it is. So what we need to address is the fact that there are people who are harming people that we love, and we're like, this is awkward, and we just look the other way, or we write it off as there's no way because these good people, and we give that person permission to just keep doing what they're doing. That's what we need to address. I am not saying most men are perpetrators. But I can't pretend that we're not talking about the fact that the ones who are overwhelmingly men, even when it comes to young men. Young men who are assaulted are overwhelmingly assaulted by other men. So we're all impacted by male violence in that sense. In large part because of a phenomenon known as the bystander effect, which came into play in a big, bad way with Rehtaeh's story. Because one of the elements of Rehtaeh's story is that multiple people walked in and out of that room and either participated in what was happening or just were like, whoop, and just left the room. That's what we're talking about, is people who see stuff go down and don't step up for a whole host of reasons. Now, this is a phenomenon that is observed in the male community. That's when it first came to light, where people would like full on have a seizure in a crowded room and everyone would just kind of like sit around. And these researchers were like, you would think that the more people that are around you, the more you're shamed into doing something. But instead, people are actually less likely to join when there's other people around. Because we think someone else is gonna do something, so like, I'm not gonna stick my neck out, It's like someone else can put themselves out there. Or I look around and like nobody seems alarmed by what's happening, so I'm like, oh, I guess I don't have to put myself out there. But we cannot pretend that myths called sexual violence also come into play. I don't care how woke or progressive or chill or amazing you think you are in your room, and you're like, oh my god, no, I read like feminist Tumblr all the time, like I'm good to go. Every single person in this room at some point or another has subscribed to some horrible myth called sexual assault. And that is a huge reason why we don't intervene. So I say to you, you need to intervene if you see someone being assaulted, you're like, oh absolutely, if I see a woman like being attacked by like a creepy person in public, obviously I'm gonna stick myself out there. But like, if she's had something to drink, or like she kind of dresses a little bit slutty, or she's got like a bit of a reputation, or like she's from that neighborhood, or like blah blah blah, then like, maybe not so much. So a huge reason why we don't intervene is because we think that some people are not worthy of being saved. Whether it's because we think only sluts get raped, or because we think, oh, that's just how they treat their women in their culture, or all of our homophobic, transphobic, ableist, racist garbage, that's where it all comes into play in terms of us not intervening. We also oftentimes don't even know to recognize sexual violence for what it is. So the amount of young people that I talk to where I say, what is sexual violence? And they honestly believe that it's limited to like a stranger attacking a woman in public while she's physically fighting off. They're like, okay, that's sexual assault, but like someone being passed out is like, whatever, that's not the same thing. It is the same thing. But a huge reason why people don't intervene is because they don't even recognize that it's a problem. So they don't see what happened to Rehtaeh. They don't see what happens to young women at parties as like even being an issue. Because in their mind, that's not assault, because she's asking for it, and it's her fault for making poor choices, right? Also, people don't intervene because they're afraid it's gonna come back on them. So if you're the person who's calling out creepers at parties, people are gonna stop inviting you. Instead of not inviting the creepers anymore, which will solve the problem, people are like, let's just not invite the snitch who ruins parties, right? So that person has no incentive to speak out because they're the one who's seen as having no chill and like, oh my god, you're such a buzzkill, so like, stop what you're doing. Rather than being like, why do we allow this person to keep partying with us? And then lastly, where I hope that the vast majority of people are now at, especially after hearing Rehtaeh's story, is people who are like, okay, I get what I need to look for, I get what needs to happen, but like, what does that look like in practice? Fundamentally, this is where we want to go together. We want to work towards heading towards the right side. We currently live in a culture in which people who are assaulted are blamed. And if you don't think that's true, Rehtaeh Parsons is not here anymore, and you Google her, and people still have tons of thoughts and feelings about how she made it all up, and everybody, she just wants attention, and yada. Like, that is how pervasive victim blaming is. But by not addressing it, we're allowing perpetrators to keep doing what you're doing, because no one's stopping them. And we're telling people who want to get help not to bother coming forward, because you're not going to be listened to, you're going to be blamed, and it's just not worth it for you to put yourself out there. So suffer in silence, and hope that you turn out okay. So, I want you to have chats with the folks around you for about a minute or two around this scenario. So, right now, I don't care who you are, I don't care what your gender is, I don't know, like, doesn't matter who you hang out with. Let's say you leave this room and someone sends you a picture of a naked girl that they know, they send it to you, what are you gonna do about it? I want you to take 2 minutes to chat with the folks around you as to what you would do in this moment. Go.
Thank you.
mask in the room, it will be impossible to hear you. I want to at least give you some space to chat amongst yourselves. So when we launched this scenario in 2012, the vast majority of people said it wasn't a deal. So how many people, in having chats with folks around you, realized or thought that sharing this photo would be a big deal? Head up. Amazing. Even if you're just telling me that because you think that's what I want to hear, I'm okay with it. The reason, but what's interesting is when we usually talk about this, and when we launched in 2012, the vast majority of people told me it wasn't a big deal. They said it wasn't a big deal because if she didn't want me to see her naked self, she wouldn't have taken the photo in the first place. That's the answer that you get. And I know, because I travel across this province every single day, that typically a police officer comes to your school and says, don't sex because you're gonna go to jail for child pornography. That's the conversation, and it's limited to that. But notice how I'm not asking you whether or not you think people should be taking naked pictures. Because I think that's not, I don't think that's the right question to ask. If you think that sexting in all cases at all times is awful always and you never do it and you think it's awful, fine. That's okay. That is totally okay if it is not your jam. The issue is when the photo already exists and all we keep going back to is, well, why did you take the photo in the first place? And we just keep going back there. That's not going to solve the problem if the photo already exists. And it wouldn't have done a damn thing for Rehtaeh. Because Rehtaeh did not take that picture. But Rehtaeh was still blamed for the fact that that photo existed. And that's why we need to talk about bystanders when we're talking about online sexual violence. And we need to first of all call it what it is, which is online sexual violence. Sexting, if we're going to agree that that is our contribution to the dictionary as millennials, this is what we brought to the world, so pat yourself on the back. If we're going to agree that the word sexting exists, then we have to be clear that we're talking about consensual activity. Online sexual violence drives home the fact that we're talking about something that's not consensual and shouldn't be sort of fallen into the same umbrella as someone who's been in a relationship, who's sending pictures back and forth, and then they break up and they delete them and no one gets hurt by it. As someone who cares about ending sexual violence, I don't care about that. What I care about is things that are not consensual, and what I care about is people holding that over someone's head to bribe them, to exploit them, or to just get off on harming somebody else. That's what I care about. And why it also matters is because of the Rehtaeh example, first and foremost, right? Here's somebody who didn't even know a photo existed, who had no idea it was happening, who was still blamed for the fact that the photo existed because it was proof of her being a slut. Even in cases where people are knowingly, consensually taking selfies of themselves, and to me did research in the States where they found that a whole black pile of people, girls in particular, whose photos were circulating through their school, didn't actually want to send the picture. They were just made to believe that if they didn't, that he would break up with her, or that he would tell people that she sent it anyway, so you might as well just do it, or what, you don't trust me? Like, you're not gonna send me a picture, we're dating, you don't trust me? Okay, I'll send you a picture. Then that picture gets out, and everyone's like, oh my God, what a slut. But people don't talk about, well, why did she feel like she had to send the picture in the first place? But even above all that, if you're sitting here and you're like, this is not something that I would ever do, so like, stop talking about it. A whole black pile of us are seeing pictures that we know were never intended for us. We know they were not intended for us. And this is the part where, like, I go to bat for you all the time, and Glen is a witness. And tonight, I'm going to be talking to parents about sexting. Please send me all of your good luck vibes. It is always awkward. And I go to bat because parents are like, oh my God, back in my day, we never would have done that. Like, youth today are, like, so corrupt and terrible. And I'm like, no, they're not. They're like doing what you would have done if you had access to the internet back in the day. But that's just what's happening. So, I am here to tell you, I go to bat for you every single day, literally, as Glen is my witness. However, you have to do me a solid in return, which is when someone's photo goes viral, and you sit there and you're like, oh, I don't even know. Like, you don't get to pretend you don't know how the internet works. Everyone in this room knows that a photo doesn't just, like, go viral. People make it happen. So this matters even if you've never taken a naked picture of yourself and you would never intend to, because a whole whack pile of you, a quarter of girls and a third of guys, are going to be seeing pictures that they know damn well were not intended for them in the first place. So this is why it is your problem to talk about and to think through. And I'm also here to tell you that I understand that you live in a world that is different from mine, and I'm not old by any stretch of imagination. Well, we didn't have cell phone cameras when I was in high school. We didn't have social media when I was in high school. So it's like really easy for me to stand here and tell you that like sexting is a terrible idea that's obviously not gonna end well, so like why would you do it? That's so stupid. When I know that you live in a world in which you get mixed messages about it all the time. Where you're like, okay, well when adults do it, it's fine, but when I do it, it's not fine. Okay. If I send a picture of like a huge whore and everyone hates me, but then I also at the same time could, like I'm super stuck up and have no chill if I don't, because like everyone does it, so what does it matter? And if I send a picture, it might go viral and I'm never gonna get a job again and my life will be ruined, or I can immediately have a person that I think is amazing tell me that I'm a babe. So like, so like I'm here to tell you that I get that it's way too easy to say like don't do it, but there's 101 different messages that you get about it all the time, and 101 different reasons why people do and don't do it. What was important to understand is that fundamentally, photos going viral is not an issue of like, should you have taken the photo in the first place? It's about consent, and about the fact that everybody in this room is smart enough to know how the internet works, and is smart enough to know that if I said something to you, it's because I want you to see it. If I wanted everyone to see it, I would post it on Instagram. I would make it my Facebook profile photo, but I did not do that. I sent it to you specifically for a specific reason. Like, it's not like an old school chain mail where I'm like, I want all my friends to see this. I will send it one at a time. Nobody has time for that. If I wanted everyone to see this, I would post it in a way that everyone can see it. But I did not do that, and there's a reason for it, and the person who received that photo knows that. They pretend not to, but they do know. And also, never assume the photo you're seeing is consensual in the first place. Never assume the photo you're, even if that person, even if it looks like a selfie, you don't know the context behind it and you don't get to assume. And lastly, even if you're, so you know if you're under the age of 18 is child pornography, you know that. But in Canada, as a result of the work that folks like Glen did, it does not matter how old you are, if you're 35 years old and your photo circulates without your consent, you can still be found criminally responsible for circulating someone's photo without their consent. It is a crime in Canada now, regardless of how old you are. So you don't get to hide behind the fact of like, oh, when I'm in university, I can do what I want. You can't. So I'm gonna end by telling you what we're gonna do instead. So we've all agreed that it's a big deal to share someone's photo, we're not gonna do it, amazing. If you can avoid sending, seeing the picture, I know you can't, it just like pops up on your phone, but if someone's like, oh my God, go check out this thing, that we don't. Like, don't. Like, hot tip, if you wanna see naked pictures of people, there's like super easy ways to do that, where it's like actually consensual. So like, you don't need to do it. Secondly, the most important thing to understand is that people are taking pictures of their partners or pictures of drunk chicks at parties and they're humiliating them because they're getting away with it. But if every time you dated somebody and she sent you pictures, you sent it on to your friends, and every single one of your friends were like, you're a douche and I'm never gonna let my friends date you, what incentive would I have to keep doing that? None. But people are taking their pictures of like these chicks they've hooked up with, and they're showing them to everyone in their locker rooms, and they're like sharing it to their whole soccer team because they're getting the reaction they're looking for. People are laughing along, people are giving you props, or people are just awkwardly looking the other way. But if every time that guy did that, or that woman did that, and someone said to them, like, that's not okay, and I'm gonna tell everybody who did that, and also I'm gonna make sure none of my friends date you because you're obviously a terrible partner, then I no longer have any incentive to continue. And that is more powerful than the threat that you're gonna call the cops, because I know, I can tell you that if you're in possession of child pornography, you have to call the police, but I also know that like no one's calling 911 on their bestie, like it's just not happening. But if we're telling your friends that what they're doing is awful, then they have an incentive to stop.